Thank you for standing, folks. Please be seated.
All right. Go ahead, Mr. McGowan.
Okay, so as I was noting for the break, it's the state's burden to prove this case beyond a reasonable doubt. Stephen doesn't have to prove that he was justified. They have to prove that he wasn't. Now, if you look at instruction 34, this is a pretty important instruction for you as to justification, because it points out that Stephen is justified in threatening or using physical force, even deadly physical force, to try and prevent another from committing an aggravated assault. An aggravated assault can come from just seriously physically injuring someone. Okay? Beating someone up can be an aggravated assault. Okay? Now, there's no duty to retreat. It's right there in the second paragraph. There's no requirement that the defendant's safety, that there's any threat to the defendant's safety before he acts here. You see that third paragraph? He's allowed to use this force not just at his home, place of business, but any place in this state where he has a right to be. And he had every bit of right to be in that parking lot as the guys that were attacking him did. He had every right to walk up to that corner. There's nothing in the law that says he wasn't allowed to brandish that gun and go up to them. He has every right to be there. And he's justified in using that force if he's trying to prevent the attack, which is exactly what he was trying to do. You know, he thought that when he went up there, they would recognize they need to leave these guys alone and leave, go back to their party at the courtyard. He didn't know that these guys were that brazen, they were going to attack him, not just once, but twice. Now, I mentioned earlier about perceptions. There's a lot of different perceptions here. Some people only saw bits and pieces. Some people told you they were in shock or tunnel vision. There is no one person that saw everything. We have this Leica scan that's given from all different angles. No one had that kind of view. Okay? So we have to piece it together. Rather, you have to piece it together. And it's important to recognize the various vantage points and perceptions that people have. As many told you, they were under shock or tunnel vision. The adrenaline's going to affect their perception. Many were under the influence of alcohol. That's going to affect their perception. And there's a difference between imperfect memory and not being honest. For example, if we can pull up Exhibit 482, please. Now, you may recall this exhibit from Nick Prado's testimony. This is the diagram that he drew for the police close in time to when all of this happened. And you might recall he circled where he thought the shooting happened. And he circled the wrong end of the parking lot. It doesn't mean he's lying. That's just how his memory was at the time. In his mind, for whatever reason, the adrenaline, the alcohol, whatever reason, he thought the shooting happened right there. And he put himself on that corner very close to the shooting, but that's why he's saying he's there at the entrance of the driveway. Now, we know if he was actually much closer to the shooting, but the shooting was down in that corner. He wasn't at the end of the driveway like he's claiming. But that's his perception at the time, that he's in the corner. And interestingly, go to Exhibit 74. It's not a Google map, but it's the same misperception. Stephen, in his mind, and he told the police this over and over again, in his mind, the shooting happened at that corner near Franklin Street, the same place Prado thought it happened. Now, we all know that it actually happened at the other corner. But both of these witnesses on both sides of this had that same misperception that it happened in that corner. And that's the tricky thing with memory, is it doesn't mean that anyone's lying in this instance. It's just because of the circumstances, the chaos of the moment, the adrenaline, in Prado's case, the alcohol, they misperceived. Doesn't mean they're lying, it's just misperceptions. And it's important to keep that in mind as you go through all this evidence. Now, if we can go to exhibits 442 to 447, as we walk through this scene, we'll use the Leica scan that we've grown so accustomed to. But I think it's very important for all of you to keep in mind that it wasn't that bright. It's very difficult when we're looking at that Leica scan to keep that in mind. So that's why I'm showing you these photos, because these are the photos that the police took at the time. Yeah, this is the view looking down. Go back to the first one. Okay. This is the view of that corner from the edge, from the corner that we just looked in that diagram where Nick Prado, Stephen Jones thought the shooting happened in that corner. We know it was the other corner. This is that corner, looking at the corner where it really happened. And you can see just how dark it is. We've had testimony from many witnesses who claim they were across the street and saw and clearly could see things. This is actually in the parking lot, and you still can't see the other corner. So next one, please. This is on the sidewalk in that same area. This is where the boulders are at the beginning of the entrance into that parking lot, looking down at the corner. You can't even see the tree down there. Maybe make out a shadow of it. It's very dark. Next one, please. This is the same area on that sidewalk, a little bit closer to the parking lot, looking at that corner. This is where a lot of the guys claimed they were when they saw everything so clearly. Many of them claim they were even further back than that, when they claim they could see so clearly what happened down there. Just not credible. Next one, please. Now this is Franklin Street. This is looking down Franklin Street, and we can kind of make out that the courtyard's on the side. We could see there's the unit that Brough and Peering and Mullen shared. This is how dark it was on Franklin when this group came out and attacked Stephen and his friends. That's all we have for the nighttime photos. But keep that in mind as you're evaluating this, and we'll switch over to 316 now. Great, thanks. If we could start over on the Franklin view. I mean, look, just looking at that, it looks a lot safer already, doesn't it? You have to keep in mind how dark it was. But this is, actually, if we could go up to station 8. And just swing into the middle of the street. No, the other way. Thanks. No, a little bit to the right, please. A little bit more. Thanks. Okay, you see the right end of the screen there. That's the unit that Colin and his friends came out of. Now, we've heard conflicting testimony. Some say that they came from around the courtyard. Others say they came out that door. Doesn't really matter. Either way, they came out onto that dark street and accosted these three freshmen for no good reason. And they pushed him across the street. And if we go now to view 7, please. Just swing it around, looking up Franklin. That's good, thanks. So now Stephen and his friends, just the three of them, are standing in that street, backing up, saying, we're leaving. And a mob of drunken guys come out of that area from the courtyard and are pursuing Stephen and his friends. And we know that Brough was there. We know that Peering was there. We know that Mullen was there. Acevedo says he was standing back, and Pletke says he was standing back. Neither of them are entirely clear yet if Prado's there or not. But there's a group of them, and Austin is standing in the back as well, getting ready to throw a sucker punch. Stephen and his friends are backing up, and these guys are pursuing them. They were already across the street when Stephen got cracked by Austin. They were already leaving. There was no reason, absolutely no reason, to attack them. And when Austin did throw that sucker punch, what did the rest of them do? The rest of the Delta Chi's didn't stop, say, whoa, Austin, you're going too far. Back off. Hey, are you okay, kid? Here's your glasses. They did quite the opposite. They chased these guys. They weren't done with them. Shay and Stephen and Jacob ran up that drive. If we can turn to see the Mountain View sidewalk. They started to run into that area to leave. And these guys chased them. They weren't done with them. They pushed Shay down. They pushed Jacob down. If at that point they had just left those kids alone, they would have left. Nothing would have happened. But they pursued. They kept up the attack. And based on that, under the circumstances where he's just been punched in the head, cracked, as Austin so eloquently put it, knocked almost to the ground, hits that car. They've got blood on that car from when Stephen was punched. Knocked off his glasses, loosened the bridge in his mouth, and are now chasing him and his friends. It's under those circumstances that he realizes they're in trouble, and he runs to his car. And Jake and Shay run up that sidewalk. And these guys aren't done. They don't stop there, say, all right, we're done. Even Austin Contreras said, I'm not going to chase a dude. After throwing the sucker punch, it was apparently too much for him to continue to chase these kids. But not for Brough and Peering and the others. They kept up their pursuit. They kept up their attack. And they chased Shay and Jake all the way down that sidewalk. Now at this point, we're at over 200 feet from when they first started pursuing these kids. 200 feet. State wants to keep making a big deal out of 90 feet. We're already double that, and they're still attacking. I believe it's Station 5 we want to go to next, please. Yeah, maybe it's 2. Swing over. Yeah, thanks. So now these guys have chased Jake and Shay. And don't for a second let the state tell you that Jake and Shay weren't concerned. They were concerned. They recognized they were under attack. And they were backing up to get away. Let's look at some of Shay's statements to the police that night. This is after he's had time to calm down and reflect, but still that night when memories are fresh. What did he tell the police? yeah, he ran away after the shots were fired. That's the prudent thing to do. I'm frankly shocked more of these kids didn't run away. I hope my kids are never in this situation, but if they are, they better do what Shea did and run away. How many of these guys ran in to the scene after shots were fired? It's crazy. They did it because they were drunk. It's crazy. Shea did the right thing in running away, but that doesn't change what he saw beforehand. He saw Colin lunge at Stephen. He told the police that. And then he talked about when he got pushed down over at the entrance to this walkway and how he got up and realized these people were going to hurt us. He told the police he was terrified. He said he wanted to call the police, but they kept advancing. He didn't even think he could do that. He said they were very aggressive, smelled very drunk, and we know they were. There's no doubt about how drunk these guys were, even though this was just a Thursday gathering. They wanted to hurt us, and they weren't going to let us go. That's what Shea told the police that night. He said possibly very brutally beat us up for no reason. Very brutally beat us up. That's aggravated assault. That's what Shea was afraid of at that moment. And that's what he told the police that night. Don't for a second let this state try to tell you that these boys weren't afraid of the attack they were under by the Delta Chi's. So, now Stephen comes up to this scene. He has every right to walk up to this scene with his gun. Maybe you don't like that law, but that is the law. He has every right to walk up to that scene and brandish his gun and tell these guys to leave him and his friends alone. And it's reasonable for him to think that they're going to heed that warning and leave. That's what most people do when they see a gun. The state has gone to great lengths to say, oh, they didn't know there was a gun. They didn't know there was a gun. Plenty of guys testified they knew it was a gun. And it doesn't matter, from Stephen's perspective, if Colin knew it was a gun or not. He charged right at Stephen. And at that point, you have to put yourself in Stephen's shoes. Is it reasonable when this guy and his buddy are charging at you downhill? Is it reasonable to not shoot? It's not. No one ever wants to be in that position. But once he's there and they're charging at him, he has no choice. He had absolutely no choice at that point. He waited until the last moment. And we know from the medical examiner, this isn't Stephen's claim. This isn't what anyone else perceived. Okay, this is medical evidence that shows, because of the stippling, that Brough was within two feet. No further than 2 feet at the time that Stephen shot. He waited until he could. From many of these Delta Chi's, and I've covered some of them, I remember correctly, Austin wasn't even really a Delta Chi, just a friend of theirs, but seemed like he'd fit right in, though. Peering clearly told the police that he jumped that bush to calm down Colin. He was mainly trying to calm down Colin. But he took the stand here and tried to tell you that he jumped after Colin was shot. And frankly, it doesn't matter from Stephen's point of view. That's the point of view that matters. That's the point of view you have to evaluate. He's downhill, and he's got two guys charging at him. It doesn't really matter what Peering's thinking at the moment. You know, we heard from Acevedo. That's how we know the direction they pursued them, because Acevedo was very clear. I took him step by step, and he kept saying, yes, these were the guys that were there, and yes, they were pursuing, and yes, Stephen and his friends were backing up, and yes, they were pursuing. All the way through, over 200 feet of attack that Acevedo witnessed. And he witnessed Prado throwing a punch. He told you that. That's his brother. But he fortunately decided to tell the truth on a stand and admitted that Prado threw a punch on the sidewalk. So when Prado takes a stand and tells you, oh, Stephen looked me dead in the eye and then shot me, you know not to put too much stock in what Prado says, because he also tried to claim that he wasn't there, that he didn't throw a punch, that he was further back, and that he ran up only after the shooting. He wishes he was Acevedo, that he was just hanging back and ran up after the shooting. But he wasn't. He was part of the fray. He was throwing punches. These guys were so brazen, they kept up their attack. Even after Stephen demonstrated that he would use force to defend himself, they kept up the attack. He put the gun away. He started to give first aid. He said, call 911. And what does Pletke decide to do? He decides to tackle the kid and try to take the gun. And once he acted, putting Stephen in a headlock, his buddies joined in, started punching Stephen, kicking Stephen. One of them's got his arm twisted. That's how brazen these guys were. No one's really talked much about Zach Vopo. To this point, it seems like the only point of his testimony was comedic relief. But it wasn't really funny under these circumstances. There was one thing he said that was quite telling. They're trying to ask him how far he went from where he was, how far did he go when he ran up. And he said, I wasn't counting my steps, I was trying to save my friends. And that's exactly the same thing with Stephen. He wasn't counting his steps. He thought he went 5 to 10, 15 feet. He wasn't sure. He wasn't counting his steps. Neither was Vopo, which is why he couldn't give you an accurate distance. And these distances, you might recall, from a lot of these witnesses, have varied quite a bit. Many of these Delta Chi's have tried to claim that Stephen was yards away when he fired. We know scientifically he was two feet or less. But Vopo wasn't counting his steps as he was trying to save his friends, and neither was Stephen. Now, I'm done with 316. Thanks. You heard from the medical examiner. This is the state's own witness. But they're medical examiners. They're not biased in any way. And what did he tell you? Quite unequivocally, that there was stippling on Brew's neck. There is no doubt that Brew was within 2 feet when Stephen shot. Stephen waited until the last moment. Couldn't wait any longer. We also know that he wasn't just 2 feet away. He was leaning forward, charging downhill. And that's important because you have to look at it from Steven's perception. And from his perception, he's gone up to these guys and they are charging at him downhill, getting very close, leaning forward. These are all aggressive acts. He perceived those acts correctly. He wasn't going to wait until this guy actually tackled him, something they later showed they were quite willing to do. If Stephen had waited any longer at all, he might not be here today. If we can bring out diagram, exhibit 470, please. You're going to have this diagram back there with you. This is from the medical examiner. Okay. The medical examiner. Yeah, just put it in front there. Maybe that's good. The medical examiner drew these lines to show the trajectory. It shows you how far Brough is leaning. And you'll be able to show, you'll be able to take this with you in deliberations and put it at the angle it has to be at for that to line up. It'll show you just how far forward Brough was. And remember, he's on a hill when he does this. It's not flat ground. He's on a hill, going downhill straight at Stephen. Now, this diagram has him at 5'7". That's based on the medical examiner's measurement when he's lying down. That's not the same thing as height. But actually, if you look at Exhibit 241, which is his driver's license, that will give you his actual height. Okay. Now, if we can zoom out, when was this license issued? This was issued in March of 2014, so over a year prior, year and a half really, prior. And he's 5'10 at this point. We don't know if he's still growing or not. We know he's heavier, because we have his weight. We know he's heavier than this now. But that's his height. He didn't shrink 3 inches during his junior year, the summer between his sophomore and junior year. He didn't shrink. So he's taller than this diagram, which makes the angle even more forward. The medical examiner also told you there's no significance to his hands and whether there was stippling on his hands. The fact that there's no stippling on his hands doesn't change the fact that he was within 2 feet. He could have his hands out in front of him as he's charging Stephen and not get stippling on him. It doesn't mean he wasn't within 2 feet. He was clearly within 2 feet. But what is significant about his hands, when you look at them, are all the scabs. They want you to believe that Colin was this peaceful guy, never hurt a fly. He's got a lot of scabs consistent with fighting on his hands. And regardless of anything he'd ever done in his past, that night, he clearly wasn't being peaceful. Maybe it's the BAC of 0.285, although many of his friends testified that he didn't drink any more than usual. So he either usually gets that blitzed, or he was more drunk than usual. Either way, it's extreme intoxication. What did the doctor tell you? For someone who doesn't have experience drinking, once you get up to 3, you're usually passed out. But not Colin. He's raring to go. He's chasing guys over 200 feet. He's charging at guys who have a gun pointed at him. He also had Xanax in his system. The doctor told you about the paradoxical effect of Xanax mixed with alcohol. It's very dangerous. They tell you do not mix Xanax and alcohol. Colin did. And Colin didn't have a prescription for that Xanax. Because if he did, you better believe the state would have shown it to you. They would have said he had a prescription. He was fine. He didn't. Which means, in addition to getting himself up to a .285 on a gathering on a Thursday, he's abusing prescription drugs. Unfortunately, that made him very aggressive. And it made him make poor decisions to charge at Stephen downhill. And who knows what other poor decisions he would have made if Stephen didn't act to stop him when he did. We also heard from the ER doctor that Zintec's wounds were an upward trajectory. And I showed you earlier about where Zintec actually was when he was shot. The state tried to gloss over that. They had Zintec testify that he only went a couple feet before he dropped, which makes no sense because we know exactly where he was from the blood splatter. We have the trail that he ran. We know he covered way more than 2 feet. He ran down that whole sidewalk after he was shot. And he was south of where Colin was shot, closer to the trees, and very close to where Stephen was tackled. And he told the police that he was running towards Stephen to get his gun. He was going to be part of the group that were pummeling Stephen to try and get his gun. That's why Stephen had to act. He did not have any time to wait for Zintec and whoever else was going to pile on top of him and take that gun. And then who knows what happened next. So he did what he could. The only thing he could do in that moment was pull out the gun and try to shoot in the air to get the crowd to disperse. Unfortunately, for Nick Prado and Kyle Zintec, he was still being tackled when those shots went off. But they were still upward shots. He was laying on the ground. Prado was standing above him. Zintec was standing and turning. And that's why he has an upward trajectory in his injury. It's consistent with Stephen pointing up in the air as he shoots. Which, of course, we also know from the witness, Ms. Conrad, another witness the state didn't want you to hear about. And, of course, there's also the tree over in that same area where Kyle is that was shot, consistent with an upward trajectory. And then there are the missing bullets, two of them. So we know one hit the tree and seven hit the individuals. So there's two more bullets that are missing, consistent with being shot in the air. So who knows where those bullets are now? If he was aiming at people and shooting, if he was aiming at people, they would have found those bullets. But he wasn't aiming at people. He was just trying to get this group off of him. As I said at the beginning, you don't need a weapon in your hand to be a threat to someone's life. Colin Brough, the moment that he decided to charge at Stephen, was a threat to Stephen's life. It was 2-on-1, charging downhill. Stephen is on asphalt. If they get to him, they could kill him. That's a lethal threat. We don't have to speculate about what would happen. If it's within the realm of possibility, it's a lethal threat. And given how aggressive these guys were, it's certainly in the realm of possibility. Ask yourself, would you want to take a chance on letting these guys tackle you and get that gun?
Objection, improper argument.
That's, well,
overruled.
That's the viewpoint that you have to look at this case from. What would you do if you were standing there and these guys were charging at you?
Same objection, Judge.
Overruled.
He had no choice at that point. He couldn't turn and run. They would tackle him at that point. And he had every right to be there at that moment You're not deciding whether it was wise for him to leave the car. He had every right to leave that car and walk up to that scene. Instruction 34, he had every right to be there. He doesn't have a right, duty to retreat. He had every right to that corner of that parking lot. And they charged at him. At that point, he had no choice. He had to shoot to stop that dual threat charging right at him. And he waited as long as he could. Under these circumstances, he acted reasonably. It's not a situation any of us would want to ever be in. But under these circumstances, with these two guys charging right at him, he acted reasonably. He did not have a choice. And if they didn't keep attacking him, nobody would have gotten shot. You know, and they're still attacking him. The prosecution, instead of recognizing what is plain as day to everyone else, that Stephen was acting under fear, the prosecutor is trying to sell you this bill of goods that he premeditated, that he was retaliating, that he's an assassin on a rampage, none of which is consistent with the facts. It's frankly laughable to try and claim that Stephen is an assassin, that he was on a rampage. The rampage were these Delta Chi's who chased these kids down into that parking lot. That was the rampage. Remember, any doubt in this case goes to Stephen. That's the law. That's what beyond a reasonable doubt means. Any doubt, as you evaluate this evidence, goes to Stephen. And there is no doubt that Stephen was scared out of his mind, not out for vengeance. That doesn't make any sense. There's no doubt that he and his friends were under attack. Absolutely no doubt. There's no doubt that Brough and Peering were charging downhill at Stephen. And he waited until the last moment. There's no doubt that he was tackled. They were pummeling him. After he put the gun away, said call 911, and was trying to give first aid. And there's no doubt that he was trying to shoot upward to get them to disperse, not aiming at anyone in particular. And under the circumstances, that was a reasonable thing to do. Because if he waits any longer, they get that gun. And do you just think about what would happen if any of these Delta Chi's, as drunk as they were, had their hands on a gun? Would have been a lot worse. Now, when you look at all the evidence in this case, evaluate all this evidence through the eyes of Stephen at that moment that he's under attack, there is no doubt, no doubt whatsoever, that he's innocent of all of these charges. We expect you to find the same.
Thank you, Mr. McAllen. Thank you, sir.
Ready?
Can I see counsel for a second?
A little mix of everything, right? That's what I told you. Pay attention. Is it going to be a mix of everything? That's what it was. Even the defense said at some point that negligent homicide sounds better than the rest of these charges. They don't even believe their own self-defense story. They're asking you to find him guilty of negligent homicide now? Throwing things against the wall and seeing what sticks. Listen, defense counsel repeating himself over and over again does not make things true. Okay? Consider all the evidence you've heard in this case. Don't consider what the defense counsel said as truth. Recall from your own memories, from your own notes, what you recall. And understand that neither one of us has perfect memories about what the witnesses said. The 12 of you are going to be able to come together and remember things a lot better. So rely on your own memories and notes about what happened in this case. defense wants to blame the state for, I guess, prosecuting the case. They said that we called it a rampage. No, that's what Shay McConnell called it when he saw the defendant showing up with a gun. He ran away because he thought the defendant was going to be on a rampage. Those words is what Shay McConnell described it as. He was afraid of the defendant. This idea that the defendant was helping his friends is just ridiculous. He told the police over and over and over, 7 times by his own admission, that he was standing right outside of his car because he was protecting himself. It wasn't until he got here, took the stand, and said, well, actually, I was protecting my friends. Because he had to have a reason, right, that he went 90-plus feet. Can't have it both ways. The defense counsel said the defendant waited to the last moment, last minute, to shoot. Had no other choice. We're just dismissing accountability completely from this case, aren't we? Because the defendant had a choice when he was at his car not to get out of his car and go toward this group. He had a choice not to bring a gun. He had a choice not to call the police or to call the police. He had a choice every step of the way. And just because he made the wrong decision, the wrong choices, doesn't mean he gets off from these charges. The defendant had choices that he made, and he made the choice to retaliate. The defense did a lot of cherry picking just now. And again, rely on your memories and your own notes about what the witnesses testified to. The defense wants you to recall Acevedo's testimony that he saw Nick Prado, who he thought Nick Prado was throwing a punch that night. Remember that? That's what the defense wants you to remember. Not that Nick Acevedo testified that Colin Brough stepped forward with his hands up in a questioning manner. They don't want you to remember that part. Or that Abby Norcutt testified here and said that she saw Nick Prado, a person that surely she would recognize because it was her boyfriend at the time, standing in the street before the shots rang out. Defense wants you to remember that Shane McConnell said he was scared, but not that he said he was also scared of this man over here who's on trial, the defendant, for bringing a gun. Doesn't want you to remember that Shane McConnell said they were never surrounded. Jake and Mike said they were never surrounded. The defense kept saying that Kyle Zentek was going for the gun. Well, if you recall from Kyle Zentek's testimony, what he said was to the police, I might have been going for the gun, maybe. He didn't really remember. What he does remember, what the defense doesn't want you to recall from Kyle's testimony, was that he saw that light shining on him and that he turned to run away. And now the defense wants you to think about that as, well, Kyle was attacking the defendant, so surely he deserved to get 2 shots in the back. Ridiculous. And this trajectory suggesting that he was shooting up in the air. Imagine if Kyle was turning and was in this position. Would he not also get an upward trajectory? Of course. You just heard about the paradoxical effect again, alcohol and Xanax. Paradoxical means it's not common, right? It's not what you would expect. Paradoxical, as the doctor told us, Dr. French, happens in 1% of people, maybe as high as 13%, but when Mr. Shea cross-examined him, he said that was in studies where people were already unstable. And so this is not a common occurrence. But the defense wants you to speculate and say, well, that must have been the situation here, surely, without any evidence. Defendant's argument, if you remember what he was saying, was based solely on what the defendant was stating in this case. But you have to consider all the testimony. Remember that instruction that tells you what the defendant says, it has to be measured against all the other evidence, and it has to be measured at the same way as every other witness. So he doesn't get a pass because he took the stand and told you some things that he wanted you to hear. No, you consider his testimony in light of all the other evidence. The defense wants to suggest that there's some conspiracy theory here between the Delta Chi's, that somehow they got together and formulated some story to try to pin a murder on somebody. Keep in mind that all the young ladies in Mountain View Dorm gave a similar account of what they described. Keep in mind that Jake and Shay gave a similar account of what was observed that night. This is an important point to make, because when the defense asked some of these witnesses, well, did you get together and discuss notes? And they denied it, and they said, no, that is the evidence. A lawyer's questions are not evidence. Innuendo, suggestion, that's not evidence. Evidence only comes from the witness stand. So when they said, no, we did not get together, and when they talked about how they talked to the police that very night, that's the evidence. Lawyers' questions are not evidence. Let's talk about the medical examiner, about Colin Brough. The defense was right. He wasn't on flat ground. And he was at a .285 BAC. They want it both ways. You see, they want Colin to be this raging drunk that night, but they also don't want you to think about the fact that he had to step over a 6-inch curb and he was walking on unlevel ground. Is it just as likely that Colin could have been falling in the moment that the defendant shot him? Absolutely. And when they talk about 2 feet away, remember, this is one injury. They're stippling on one of these injuries. And it's not 2 feet away from the defendant, it's 2 feet away from the muzzle of the gun. Keep that in mind. Let's talk about some more speculation that the defense just made. What the blood would have shown at the scene. He suggested that the blood would have shown that there was some attack on the defendant. Really? What evidence is there to support that? That's speculation. One of the jury instructions tells you not to guess about the evidence, meaning you cannot speculate about what the evidence may or may not be. If you didn't hear from the witness stand, then that's what the evidence is. The defense suggests there's some type of analysis, branch analysis, I suppose, to tell you something about what happened to that tree. That the state would have found bullets if they hadn't been shot in the air? Really? What evidence is that based on? What expertise is that based on? This is the most egregious example the defense just gave. That Colin Brough had scabs on his hands because he was fighting at some prior time. Did you hear any evidence from this stand about that? That's improper. What you heard from the witness stand was actually Amanda Conrad, one of the defendant's own witnesses, tell you that Colin was a peaceful person. And when the defense got up and said, would it change your mind if he was at a .285 BAC? No. What if he had Xanax in his system? No. She was adamant that Colin was a peaceful person. That's the evidence, not some speculative argument by the defense. Consider what the defendant was saying, what he lied about, what was inconsistent with the other witnesses. Because there's a pattern. These lies were by design. Remember, he told you that he read the book on self-defense. He knew the buzzwords. So when he, after he told Officer LaBarle that he was wrong for what he did, then he tells the police, well, there were a lot of people coming at me, and they were saying they wanted to kill me, and I got piled on. All these things that were inconsistent with other witnesses. The only things he really lied about were the things that he tried to use to bolster his false self-defense claim. But by the way, even all these lies put together don't amount to self-defense. The state kept talking about 90 feet because it matters, and the defense kept ignoring it because it matters. It matters because 90 feet shows reflection. 90 feet shows premeditation. 90 feet shows that he was in no apparent danger while he was at his car. The defense wants you to rely on the defendant's own self-serving testimony about, well, I didn't intend on shooting anybody. I didn't intend on killing anyone. Of course, he's not going to say that on the stand. So what you have to do is dig a little deeper. Look at the actions. What did he do? What actions refute that statement? There's an instruction that I keep referring to. It's the intent inference. It says you can examine all the facts and circumstances to derive what the defendant's intent was. Actions speak louder than words. The defense or the defendant, what were his actions? Straight to his car, straight to his gun, and then straight back to shoot the victims in this case. The defense kept saying, of course the defendant was in fear. How can the state argue otherwise? Well, here's an example. The defendant shot two people who were unarmed, Colin Brough, Nick Peering, and then he put his gun away. What happened to those 10 or 12 really dangerous people? I guess he wasn't concerned about them. And then later, after he claims to have been piled on by 5 to 10 people, he puts the gun down. Remember, Chase Jones comes out. The sirens are in the air, by the way. He's got no other options. Defendant has to put the gun down at this point. But he does not unload the gun. He does not remove the magazine to make it safe. With all those dangerous people around, he didn't think to make the gun safe so they couldn't use it against him. Actions speak louder than words. One of the exhibits that was just shown to you, exhibit 482, just a note on that. Defense was talking about misperceptions, how Nick Prado said, circle this area is where the shots occurred. That wasn't my memory from the testimony. Rely on your own memories and notes. I believe Nick Prado testified that he identified where he first saw the group in that exhibit, 482. Look through your instructions, and you'll find that there is no law that says it's okay to just point a gun at people because you have a gun. There is no instruction in there that will tell you what the defense suggested, that it's okay to come up on a group of people and point a gun at them if they're not attacking you, if there's no deadly physical force. Now listen, there was a confrontation. State proved it to you. The state proved that the defendant was punched in the face. The state proved to you that there was a confrontation in the street and that this group migrated, but it wasn't a chase down because Jake and Shay both told you that they were never surrounded, that there was no physical altercation except for those pushes on the ground beyond that, and that the group was dispersing. And Jake said to you that he was sticking around because he wanted to get his hat. That was the level of concern Jake and Mike had. Shay McConnell said about that concern, it was not necessary for there to be a gun. When he saw the defendant with the gun, he ran. The defense keeps misrepresenting how dark it was with those dark photos. You saw the body cam just a moments before, Exhibit 353, and the officer's telling you that those photos are not as dark, or are darker, in fact, than what it looks like when you're there. And you know that from your own experience. You know that when you're in a dark place or outside and you're taking a photo, you're going to light up with that flash 10 feet in front of you and everything else is going to be dark. The defense said that the defendant walked 15 feet away from his car, or he said that he walked 15 feet away from his car. That's not what the testimony was. In fact, he claimed that there were guys 10 to 15 feet away from his car when he was trying to get his gun. That was proven false because there's nobody that chased him to his car, and he realized, and in fact, he admitted on the stand that he was alone at his car. What he testified, or what he told the police over and over again, was that he was right in front of his car when he shot two people. And of course, that was wrong as well. And so he had to develop this other theory that he was trying to help Jacob and Shay 90 feet away. The defense suggested that the defendant was under so much pressure, he couldn't make any choices. He was alone in his car. How about picking up your phone and calling the police? You can still do that, by the way, with 1% battery. You know that. How about taking your keys out, turning on the car, and driving away? That was a choice you could have made. How about just arming yourself? If you're so nervous, just arming yourself and staying in your car. Nobody was busting through the windows of the car. Nobody was trying to grab his gun. There was no struggle. All these fast people that were chasing him down strangely never caught him, because that wasn't what happened. Now, I will agree with one thing the defense said, which is about sympathy. You're not to consider sympathy when you decide this case. Right? The instruction tells you, set that aside. We had this discussion during jury selection. Set that aside. Set aside sympathy. Set aside prejudice when you make your decisions. So when you heard the defense elicit testimony about how distraught the defendant was when he was talking to the police that night, what does that matter? Because he regretted shooting four people? Sure, you might be distraught, but you can't consider his emotional state when you consider what he did that night. Because what happened before that was that he got his gun and he walked 90 feet to shoot these people. That does not undo the premeditation. It does not undo the decision he made before he shot these four people. Let me circle back to self-defense, because I didn't hear the defense attorney describe to you why self-defense even applies in this situation. Now, granted, he said, well, now it's negligent homicide, so maybe they're abandoning that position. But self-defense says it has to be deadly physical force, right? You have to be threatened with the same level of force that you're using, proportionality. This is an important concept in self-defense. And what is deadly physical force? It's defined for you in this instruction. It says it's force used with the purpose of causing death or serious physical injury, or force which in the manner of its use or intended use is capable of creating substantial risk of death or serious physical injury. Who besides the defendant was using that type of force? Nobody. Nobody was. Self-defense is just out. It does not apply in this case. Secondly, apparent danger. Where was the apparent danger when the defendant was in his car? There was none. When he got out of his car and walked toward the group, he was now the aggressor. He was the one pointing a gun at someone. And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, self-defense goes both ways. Something the defense didn't talk to you about. It goes both ways. When the defendant arrived at that group and pointed the gun in Colin Brough's face, Colin Brough had every right to attack the defendant, to prevent an attack on himself. The defendant was the one that walked 90 feet. Colin Brough is not able to walk one or two steps to protect himself. It goes both ways. Same thing when the defendant shoots two unarmed kids and Nick Plecky is watching from the side and sees what the defendant is capable of, wants to prevent further criminal activity, wants to prevent further injury or death. Nick Plecky is inside his own, he has the right, just like anyone else, to prevent a crime from occurring. He just saw the defendant shoot two people. Goes both ways. Regarding defense of another or a third party, there wasn't much discussion on this, but it's still deadly physical force. It still has to be deadly physical force. So when Shea and Jacob describe zero deadly physical force being presented to them, then it doesn't apply. This instruction does not apply. When Jacob and Shea tell you that they weren't surrounded, even though the defendant assumed or perceived that, although it wasn't reasonable, self-defense does not apply, or defense of others does not apply. You were asked to look at instruction 34, which is an instruction about crime prevention. And one of the things instruction 34 tells you is that, again, just like self-defense, you can only use deadly physical force if it's reasonable and it's immediately necessary to prevent a crime. What crime was he actually preventing? Because Jake and Shay were not being surrounded, not being attacked. And when he saw that, when he perceived that, he should have known that there was no crime being prevented at that time. There was no crime actually being enacted at that moment. And it has to be aggravated assault with serious physical injury. So you have the instruction about what serious physical injury is. Jacob and Shea were pushed to the ground once. The defendant was not preventing crime. In fact, his statements to the police suggest that he didn't even go over that 90 feet. This is just a new theory that the defense has tried to develop during trial. Now, there's an instruction about a supervening event. And the defense touched on this. I just want to make sure you understand what this is talking about. This is instruction 35. The last or second to last paragraph says that a superseding intervening event is an event that is unforeseeable by the defendant, and with the benefit of hindsight may be described as abnormal or extraordinary. What did the defendant think was going to happen when he shot two people that were unarmed and there were other people watching? Was it not foreseeable that someone might try to prevent him from shooting other people? Was it not foreseeable that Nick Plecky might try to get the gun away from the defendant? Instruction 35 doesn't apply because there wasn't anything that wasn't foreseeable in that moment after the defendant shot two people. Now, in the verdict form that you'll get from the judge, you need to start from page one. As the judge instructed you, you start with first-degree murder. All right? That's the charge the defendant is facing. And you deliberate on that. And then you go through the instructions as follows, page by page. When the defense suggested to you that this isn't first-degree murder, or it wasn't second-degree murder, or manslaughter, that maybe it's negligent homicide, I want to talk about second-degree murder with you for a moment, because the defendant testified in this case to a couple things that put him squarely under the category of second-degree murder, if you cannot agree as to first. And here's what it says. Where's my clicker? Oh. All right, we're going to have to wait for it to warm up. As you go through these instructions, as the instruction tells you, the first, very first instruction tells you, you'll find out that some of these instructions don't apply. And some of these instructions may be instructions like self-defense, that won't apply, or defense of others, that won't apply, crime prevention, the things that we've gone through. So second-degree murder is defined in your instructions as well, and it says that the state can prove second-degree murder three different ways. The first is that the defendant intentionally caused death, okay? And there's no element of premeditation, just that the defendant intended to cause death of Colin Brough. The second way is that the defendant knew his conduct would cause death or serious physical injury, and it actually ended up in Colin Brough's death. And the third way is that the defendant recklessly caused death, manifesting extreme indifference to human life. I want to focus on this second one. The defendant took the stand in this case, and he said, when I asked him, what happens when you shoot someone in the chest? What did he say? He said, a lot of the times it's fatal. And then I asked him, or it would cause serious physical injury, right? And he said, yes. Right here, even the defendant admits what he did was second-degree murder. If it ain't self-defense, then it's surely second-degree murder. This is the minimum. This is the floor. You shouldn't have to go beyond second-degree murder because this is what the defendant admitted on the stand. Now, the defense suggested, well, there's this other instruction about manslaughter. Well, manslaughter doesn't apply, and here's why. Because there has to be adequate provocation. And this instruction tells you that words alone are not sufficient to reduce it to manslaughter. Words alone. Did Colin Brough ever put a finger on the defendant? No. There's zero evidence that he did anything beyond words. And in fact, we didn't even hear words from Colin Brough toward the defendant. Must not have been a cooling off period. This is the same idea behind premeditation. If the defendant went to his car 150 feet away, he was at his car for a moment, he got his gun out, and then he walked 90 feet. There was over 240 feet of cooling off period, of time and travel that elapsed. And then the last point, the provocation must have been from the victim who was killed. Again, the Colin Brough, from all the evidence you've heard, didn't do anything toward the defendant except, as the defense wants to characterize it, charge the defendant. But you've heard from other witnesses that this charge was simply a step forward, or a lunge, and when I asked Jay McCollum to describe what a lunge was, he did this, step forward. So manslaughter doesn't apply. A negligent homicide, I won't even waste your time on, because that doesn't apply. The defendant said he intended to shoot these people. He intended to shoot Colin. He intended to shoot Kieran. This wasn't a negligent act. So as you go along, you will be eliminating instructions and deciding that some things don't apply. You don't have to be unanimous as to the theory. And what I mean by that is, as to second-degree murder, you don't have to be unanimous. But as to first-degree murder, which is where you start, and which is what the state is asking you to find, you don't have to be unanimous as to the theory behind that either. So for instance, some of you may believe that the defendant reflected in the moment he went to his car 150 feet. Some of you may believe it was at his car where he reflected. Some of you may believe it was during the 90 feet that he walked back. And some of you may believe it was in the moment when he had the gun pointed at Colin Brough and he was waiting. Is Colin Brough, is this person going to step toward me? Is he going to confront me, challenge me, now that I have the power? The reflection could have been in that moment as well. Only the elements have to be unanimous. The defense talked to you about the burden. The burden is beyond a reasonable doubt. That's the state's burden. The state embraces that burden. And what that says, what the instruction tells you, is that the state need not prove the case beyond any doubt or all doubt, but beyond a reasonable doubt. And at this point, ladies and gentlemen, you should be firmly convinced about what the defendant did in this case, about the design of his lies, about what the victims testified to, and the young ladies from Mountain View Dorm, and how it all comes together to form a picture of murder and of an unjustified shooting. And because of that, the state is asking you to find him guilty as charged on first-degree murder and all counts of aggravated assault. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Barker. Everybody.
Members of the jury, at the start of trial, we all felt that it would be wise to have two alternate jurors in case someone got sick or was otherwise unable to complete their service. To make the selection of the alternate juror fair, we wait until the end of the trial, and then we'll draw the name of two of the jurors at random. Now, those jurors will be excused and will not participate in the verdict deliberations. However, the two jurors who will be excused will not be released from the admonition because it may be necessary to bring one or both of the jurors back in case one of the 12 jurors who are deliberating are unable to complete those deliberations. Sometimes the jurors who are chosen may feel disappointment or they may feel relief. I don't know how the alternate jurors who are about to be chosen here will feel. But I want them to know on behalf of the prosecution, Mr. Jones and defense, and myself, how deeply we appreciate your being on our jury and giving us and our county your service. Now, folks, again, I want to personally thank you for your service here to our county and to all the parties in this case. What I'm going to ask you to do is leave your notebooks with Cheryl. Once the jury has reached their verdicts, you'll be notified as to what those verdicts are. And again, all of your notes will be destroyed in this case. So on behalf of, again, all the parties, our county, and myself, thank you. You are excused.
No, we just those two. Okay. Yeah, those two. Okay. Okay. Thank you. Please be seated. Folks, as I indicated in the last jury instruction, in a few minutes you're going to go to the jury room. You'll then discuss and vote on the case until you've reached your verdicts in this case. We will give you the exhibits that have been admitted into evidence. We know that some of them are digital imagery, and we are working to provide a computer to help you view those exhibits if you wish to view them. Also, there was obviously a weapon that was admitted into evidence, as well as the magazine and the live rounds. We will make the gun available to you to view, but once you've determined that you've examined that exhibit as you wanted to, and you want to see the bullets or the magazine, we'll remove the gun and then we will give you the magazine with the live rounds. Now, again, before you get started, sometimes you have some personal matters that you want to attend to. That's fine. The door to the jury room will be left open. Once you've settled down and started to deliberate, the jury room door is going to be closed. I want to emphasize everything you do in there will be secret and confidential. The bailiff will be able to hear a knock on the door, though, so if you need anything, just knock. Now, again, I went over somewhat about the questions that you have. Use your juror question forms if you have any questions for us. Again, please be patient. I do have to get the attorneys together. We do have to review the question. We have to determine the answer to be given to you, and then we have to send it back to you. Now, if mealtime comes during your deliberations, then we will feed you at county expense. Please understand that would not come from the cottage place or someplace like that. We do have some menus back there, and we would just simply ask that you order off the same menu. It will make it easier for my judicial assistant and I to pick up the food and bring it to you. If you're working close to 4:30, I'll simply ask what your plans are. Again, you can set your schedule and vary it to meet your needs. But you have to let me know what that is, and then I get the final say. I understand that no one can tell you how to reach your verdict. All I can say is that you start by electing a foreperson to preside over your deliberations. You then discuss the case and vote on it until all of you agree on your verdict. Next, you have to fill out the verdict forms, as I indicated, and you'll notify either Cheryl or Eli. Once you've told the bailiff that you have a verdict, the bailiff must notify everyone and see that they are collected together in the courtroom. Please be patient. This may take a while. Now, the foreperson should keep all of the verdict forms and bring them into the courtroom. All the notepads should be gathered and given to the bailiff, who will see that they are destroyed. Finally, we will come back to the courtroom, and the verdict will be presented to me. I will inspect the verdict forms. I'll give them then to Marie, who will read them into the record out loud. Counsel, are there any matters that we should address before we allow the jurors to begin deliberations?
Not from the state thing. Not from the federal.
All right. Is it going to be both you and Eli? All right. Cheryl, if Eli and you would come forward, please. Thank you, folks. All right, folks, we stand at recess pending the jury's deliberations. All right, courtroom can now be seated. Are there any matters outside the presence of the jury that we need to address? State?
Not from the state.
Mr. Davidson?
I want to make a record on one issue if I could, Judge.
Go ahead.
Your Honor, during the course of the closing arguments, the prosecution, I believe in their first closing, made, if not a direct argument, an inference or insinuation to the jury that Mr. Jones did not make any assertion or articulate any self-defense claim until after he was in a police audience or something along those lines. The prosecutor knows that's not true because it was the prosecution that filed their motion in limine to preclude what they characterize as self-serving hearsay statements that Mr. Jones made very early on. He was in police custody along the lines of, please help me, why did they punch me, why did they chase me? These were statements he made in the car long before he was transported to the police station and had a police audience. I don't think it's appropriate for either side, particularly when that particular side is the one that was the proponent of evidence being precluded, to, if not directly tell, suggest to the jury that there's evidence there, not there, when they know it exists, they just happen to have it precluded. Similarly, Judge, there was absolutely no question, answer, or anything else in the record in this case about Mr. Jones' demeanor while he was testifying, and that was also argued by the state. Third and most concerning, Judge, excuse me, as you recall, we had a lot of discussions over the past few working days about which justification instructions would be given and which ones wouldn't. The defense wanted a defensive display of a firearm instruction. The state objected to it. The court didn't give it. When we discussed that, Judge, it was basically understood, if not represented by the state, that they weren't going to be arguing or insinuating that Mr. Jones was acting outside the law or that he was breaking the law when he had the gun in his possession from the time he was at the car until the time the shooting occurred. Well, that's exactly what Mr. Barker just insinuated. And I think when the court withholds an instruction that's predicated on an understanding, or a representation by the state that they're not going to make a certain argument, that's a problem. And so for those reasons, collectively, Judge, I would ask for a mistrial.
Mr. Barker.
Thank you. I did not make any inference to the fact that the defendant may have made other statements. I'm talking about the first argument made by the defense. I was very specific in my wording. And know this, Judge, that when I talked about this with Mr. Shea, we made it very clear that the statements the defendant made to Nick Acevedo, Nick Plecky, and Debbie DeLabaro, I was very specific about these are the statements he made to these three people. I wasn't referencing any other statement he may have made. I wasn't suggesting that he didn't make any other statements. But these statements in particular were relevant because they showed that in the very first moment, at least, with Nick Acevedo, the very first statement he made was, I don't know. And then Nick Plecky, the only statement he heard was, what did I do? And Deputy Labaro, consistent with the testimony, was, I did something wrong, or nobody did anything wrong but me. So there is no suggestion beyond that, what I stated in my first close. Secondly, there was testimony. In fact, defense counsel knows this because he was the one doing direct exam of the defendant and asked him what kind of emotional state. This came out two or three different times. And the defendant testified that I was crying at different times, or I was emotional at different times, or distraught at different times. The record will bear that out. The third thing regarding defensive display, I was not arguing that the defendant committed a crime when he had a gun in his hand. What I'm arguing is that he reflected and he walked toward the group with the intent to hurt somebody. That's the problem. So for all those reasons, it should be denied summarily. Thank you.
I am going to, I think there's some issues that were a little bit concerning. I tried to, as best I could, reflect on the testimony that was given. I think that I think at this point, though, that the error, if any, did not rise to a level to grant the motion for mistrial. The motion is denied.
Sorry. The alternative, would the court consider amending the jury instructions to provide the jury a defensive display justification instruction at this point?
Judge, again, I wasn't arguing that the defendant couldn't display a weapon. The problem is the defendant went and pointed at someone's face. That's the argument I made. It has nothing to do with defensive display. And the defendant isn't charged with displaying a weapon, so there's no reason to give that instruction.
counsel flips through the instructions addressing the jury in closing argument and challenges them to find an instruction in there that says what Mr. Jones was doing is not illegal, if that's not an insinuation, I don't know what is.
Well, I think that the defensive display of a weapon is a justification for the display of the weapon, or perhaps a disorderly conduct with a weapon. I think in this case, and I think what I heard was not that there was anything wrong with Mr. Jones walking to the place where ultimately the young men were shot with a weapon, but that the walking to the place with a weapon was the act of premeditation. And in this case, my concern is that the jury may have a tendency to think that the defendant, that they should consider that the defendant did something wrong if we give them, in essence, a defensive display justification, even though he was not charged with anything that brought a charge for wrongful display of a weapon. So I'm going to deny the motion to submit a defensive display instruction.
Judge, just one other thing on the record, not related to this, but we are making contacts to make sure we can get software downloaded to that computer, so we'll have that available this afternoon, hopefully. So I'll inform the court when that happens.
All right. To the family of the victims, to prosecution, to Mr. Jones and Mr. Jones' family, the defense, I know this has been a very difficult case. As I indicated outside the presence of the jury, there's an awful lot of pain here, but I want to thank the attorneys for the manner in which they have represented their respective clients. I think all of you have done an outstanding job, and it was an honor to preside over this trial. We'll go ahead and stand at recess.
Thank you, Your Honor.